much sadly that I don't understand your language, but I feel that you talk from the heart, and that is the most important. Well, Emergency Architecture and Human Rights is a studio of architecture, non-profit studio of architecture, that we decide to work in the most vulnerable situation, in general, where the architects don't go. Our main topic now is architecture is a human right. I will explain really short this because this is a long explanation. It's a long discussion that we will develop the whole year from 2018 to 2019, but we want to prove that architecture is a human right. Basically, I can say that the humanity produces knowledge. Every time we are producing more and more and more knowledge, that is a kind of intrinsic and immanent sense of the humanity. Sometimes we don't know what we are producing knowledge. We produce a lot of chairs. I always wonder why we produce another chair. Why we need someone else? This is quite fine. We have hundreds of designers and architects produce a new chair, but that doesn't matter. That is, we need to produce knowledge and more and more and more always. This is a kind of, really a kind of destiny of our humankind. In that sense, all the knowledge is connected, it's intrinsically connected one to another. We never create something alone. Always is product of our generation, our history, our teachers, the situation that live Sammy. She came here to Switzerland and now he is studying other thing, and I understood that she would study something like bio or something else. Well, that is just because of the condition, and if you create something here, if some German scientific create a new medicine, it's because an African guy decided several thousands of years ago to cross to here. And everything is connected in that sense. In that perspective, all the knowledge that the humanity produce belong to the humanity itself. And every human being has the right to use the knowledge that the humanity produced in the planet we live. That means if we accept that the architect belongs to that knowledge, the accumulated process of the architect to belong to that knowledge, that means that architecture should be a human right, that everyone has the right to use our profession and our knowledge. We have several topics in this time. We define at least 11 urgent topics. This is one, humanitarian emergencies and resilience. For instance, this is the tsunami of 2004 in Indonesia that died around 100,000 people. That does not matter. It didn't die in that moment a lot of Europeans. Because it was Christmas and was a beach areas, and most of the European countries lose some people in that moment. That means that because it was Christmas, they start to receive a lot of money for the recovery of Indonesia, that tsunami, and earthquake and tsunami. Incredibly, we receive around 3 times more money than the money that we need to recover. But there was no plan of architects, was no human planning, was no preparation to recover the country. That means, basically, that this is not an issue of money, it's an issue of professional preparation that we don't have. Another, this is the topic number 11, in the middle is cultural processes, democratization of the architecture, well, several of these, and the 11 is the new role for the architecture. And here we have another trouble. This is the map of the world when the emergencies happen, mainly in Asia, Africa, the Andes movements. And this is the place where the architects live. It's exactly the opposite. Then we live in the most rich areas of the planet. I mean, Copenhagen also. This is a critic also for myself. You live here in Zurich. We live in the most rich area of the planet. And when we live in a poor country, we live in the richest neighborhood of that country. Then we are always out of this topic. When we talk today, we have a very interesting lunch and a very good discussion, because when we talk about architecture with another professional, with another people, we talk in function of the good design, the aesthetic, And all of these values that really several times that means nothing in some specific context. Well, this is the situation in a picture of a research that we did in 2001, 2, and 5, that at least two-thirds of the inhabitants of the planet doesn't have any connection with professional agriculture. When I say any connection, I mean that they are not able just to contract an architect. They are not able to have a material, industrial material of construction, they don't have electricity, they don't have water, they don't have urban planning, they don't have anything that some architect, professional architect, is connected with. What is the sense of this research? This means that we never can complain that we don't have job. We have plenty of jobs. We have 4.6 billion of inhabitants of the planet that are waiting for better life and maybe for the support of a professional architect. The issue that we don't create a system, we don't have the money maybe, and maybe we don't have the process to go to those places. Now, the project of Astra. Very short, this is the map of the roads, the immigration roads to north of Europe, and in that map and in that travel we identify at least 7 places where architects can work. This project is called this way, and the first is the city destruction. This is Aleppo after the war. I understood that maybe something belonged to that city or around the city. And we believe that it's possible to create more resilient cities. We should think about that, that it's possible to create more resilient cities. Second is the refugee camp. This is Sahatari refugee camp with the peak of 200,000 inhabitants. This is a planning project. It's planning by some engineers or some human planning, but this well, it's quite special, this situation. I will show a little bit more later. The International Oasis, this is the road through the Sahara. We believe that we can create international oasis with Red Cross, UN, to try to keep people out from the mafias and all the traffic that area. Fourth is the North African Harbor. Also, it has a huge opportunity to develop North Africa in relation with economic issues, new industries, and to try to balance this unbalanced situation that has the Mediterranean between South Europe and North Africa. Number 5 is the reception center in the Iceland, EU Iceland. This is Sardinia, where I work often. We have doing some projects there. Also in Copenhagen, where the refugee center. This is the situation now, but this is just the situation. It's not our project, this is the situation that exists now. In this place, are receiving the refugees in Denmark, that is around 30 kilometers from Copenhagen, 40 kilometers from Copenhagen, that make it impossible that they can walk to the city. They are in this kind of refugee center for 1, 2, 3, 5 years, waiting papers and in a kind of standby situation, when their life is totally stopped. And the 7th is the dream to return. They always want to return to some idea of the city that doesn't exist anymore. This is a map of Syria, 1,600, and now we are working in these 3 areas. In this road that I showed, we are working in Middle East, doing some playground in the refugee camp of Al-Shatila in Lebanon, in Jordan, 100 school, in Italy, working with the center of reception, and in Denmark, with the integration of the refugees. The project 100, classroom in Middle East. This is Sahatari refugee camp again. This is the process of Sahatari in 6 months. inhabitants in 6 months. I believe, or I listen to that Zurich had 400 inhabitants, 500. Imagine that he will grow up 200,000 inhabitants, 50% of the city in 6 months. That is what happened in Sahatari. But that was the situation after 6 months. In the beginning, every tent was very planned and very ordered. Immediately, people start to recreate some spaces and to move the tents. This is a map of the schools in 2014. Now there is more school than this, is around 10, but in this moment was just 3 schools, big school, that receive around 10,000 students from the 36. More or less 1/3 of the students, the possible students, were attend to the school, and 2/3 couldn't go to the school. We analyzed several of why what happened this. Dangerous places, kids need to work, was too far from the tents that they have. Then we imagine that in Copenhagen, the architectural school of Copenhagen, we imagine that we can create small schools, really, really small school and very cheap. And exactly to use to put this school inside the refugee camp in the places where they have water bottles. In these places, when the mothers need to go to pick up water, maybe in that place could be a classroom. And in place could just to build huge buildings that the donors don't keep the money to build huge buildings because the refugee camp can disappear tomorrow. In 1 year or 2 years, maybe it doesn't exist anymore. What do you do with a building of 5,000 square meters waiting for a student that don't come anymore? Then our point was, okay, create small schools. And this is what we have. We have soil people, students, some teachers, and we need blackboards, sandbags to have the soil in sand and to use a kind of old technique with the sand and with sandbags. This is all the possibilities of this technique, and this is a very ugly picture, but the first picture that the school, the student did, and it's, I like because, especially for the because it's very naive, and in the end, the project was never in that way. But it was the beginning. Another point with this technique that if you don't keep the building every year with plaster, the building disappears. Then when the refugee camp disappears, the building also will disintegrate because the plastic, the bag, excuse me, the plastic is biodegradable. Then everything will disappear if you don't take care of it. This is what happened in the Sahatari refugee camp now. This place is the main avenue. By the way, it's called Champs-Élysées. But we discovered that the conditions inside the refugee camp are very hard, but are harder outside the refugee camp. When we went there to build this school, this small school, we found out that the village that is here before originally have 10,000 inhabitants and now have double or 200% more, increasing this year to almost 30,000. And the village doesn't receive any support. All the international support is going to the refugee camp. Red Cross, UN Habitat, UNHCR, UN OCHA, everything is going to inside the refugee camp. But outside there are a lot of refugees, a lot of kids, and also Jordan have, before the war, have a lack of schools. Then we decide to build in the village the school because when the Syrians back home, these schools will remain for the Jordan. This is our team building the school in some program that we call 1+1=11 because we join different people from different cultures and we work together. Here is a girl of Palestine, another one is from Italy, another is from Denmark, Jordan, Libyan, Syrian, of course. And we try to create this system that train the trainers, the people that will build the city and they will rebuild Syria later. This is the inspiration project for our building. This is called Lehigh Houses from Syria. And this is our project. The project is 28 square meter is a classroom that costs 5,000 euros. This is the first day of class. This is the first sandstorm. Teachers complain a lot about these sticks, that we need this stick to go to replaster the building, but they complain that the kids could be very dangerous for the kids. And I will show you now the first day of class. They are doing exactly what the teacher said. And it's, but in the same way, it's a very funny project for them. They are inside this net, and that start to identify the neighborhood. The neighborhood is called the Dome neighborhood now. and the kids really like to go there, and they also increase the assistance of the school. Also, I just said that this has some problem. The plaster doesn't work, the light is not enough, but at least we were able to build in 5,000 euros. And now we have this campaign that is build 100 classrooms for 5,000 euros, then we need 500,000 of euros to build this classroom. And the project that we are doing now is Athrak School in Jordan. This is the new plot. This is the situation of the container. The students are in these containers. You imagine in that weather when you have 35 degrees, 40 degrees outside, inside of the container is 50, is 45. Then the conditions for study are extremely hard. And in winter it's the opposite. We have a rainy, cold climate inside the container and in relation with outside. The project that we build at least improve 10 degrees the condition of the containers. Then it's 10 degrees cooler in winter, that make really more possible to study in this place. This is the new project, this is one of the first pictures. This is one of the sections now. This is it has two levels, and the top is the library. And we are building four new dorms with some patios inside, some small places, in order that each classroom could have a place outside also to study. And this is finished in this place. Then we want to finish with this. I am not a humanitarian architect. We are just architects that we collect clients have less money. Thank you very much.